In the name of the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit, one God, Amen. Welcome to episode 20 of the whole Bible series, where we cover the Bible from the book of Genesis till the book of Revelation. Today we're going to cover chapter 30, 31, and 32 from the book of Exodus. We're going to talk about the altar of burnt incense, the incense, and the basin. Chapter 31, we're going to talk about honoring the Sabbath, and 32 about the great fall of the Jewish people and worshiping the golden calf. So let's get started. Exodus chapter 30 till 32. Chapter 30, we're going to cover the altar of burnt incense, the basin, the holy oil, and the incense, and we're going to talk about the sentence. First, we'll start by the altar of the burning incense. God instructed Moses to build the altar only for the incense, dimension 1 by 1 by 2 cubit. Made it out of strong acacia wood and cover it with gold inside and outside, and make a molding at the top of the altar and four horns at the four corner of the altar, and make two rings on each side so we can have poles. So nobody can touch the altar, only people can carry it through the poles. This is a picture of the acacia wood, very strong type of wood. And God gave Moses four instructions regarding the altar of the burning incense. First, you shall put it before the veil. Second, Aaron shall burn on it sweet incense every morning when he tend the lambs. You shall not offer strange incense on it, or burnt offering, or a grain offering, nor shall you pour a drink offering on it. This is a very, very important command. I'm going to say it again. You shall not offer strange incense on it, or burnt offering, or a grain offering, nor shall you pour a drink offering on it. And we'll see who violated this command and what was God's punishment for them. The fourth command is, Aaron shall make atonement upon its horn once a year with the blood of the sin offering of atonement. So only once a year, Aaron will come and anoint the horn of this altar when he offers the sin offering. Unfortunately, chapter 10 in the book of Leviticus, we'll see the two sons of Aaron, Nadab and Abihu, they offer a strange incense on this altar. And right away, strong fire came out from the altar and consumed both of them. They both got killed while they offer this strange incense. So they violated God's command, and God was so strict with them. And through the Bible, we see whenever God get a command, he always kept it. He never violated his command. Whenever he did something not to do and people violated and did it, God gave him punishment. From the time of Adam till the end of the Bible. Then he talked about the basin, and the basin should be made out of bronze and filled with water, and should be placed before the holy. When the priests go inside the holy, they should wash their hand or their feet, lest they get punished by God. And the basin actually was just a symbol of the baptism in the New Testament. So in the New Testament, we replace the basin by the baptism. Then you talk about the holy anointing oil and how you should make it. 500 shekel of myrrh, 500 shekel of cassia, 250 shekel of cinnamon, and 250 shekel of calamus, and one hint of olive oil. From this, you shall make the holy anointing oil. And it can be a holy oil for everything. When you shall anoint the tabernacle of the meeting and the ark of the testimony, the table and its utensil, lampstand and its utensil, and the altar of incense, the altar of burnt offering with all its utensil, and the laver and its base. So everything inside the tabernacle was anointed by the holy oil. And as you know, we kept the holy oil in the New Testament as a symbol of the dwelling of the Holy Spirit. And a new person, after he get baptized, he will be anointed 36 times with the holy oil. Then he's going to talk about the incense and how to make the incense, and the incense should be offered on the altar of the burnt incense. And he concludes that chapter by the census. He instructed Moses that whenever he counts the number of men 20 years and up, he should give a half shekel of silver when accounting everyone. And this should be given to the tabernacle for the service. So this is the census that they instructed to do. Every soul should offer half shekel of silver upon itself. And when we get to the book of Samuel, the second book of Samuel, chapter 24, we're going to hear about a story from King David when he got old and he wanted to number the people just to see how strong his army is. And his army officer warned him not to do that because God didn't ask for it and there should be a money should be collected to the tabernacle for it. However, David didn't listen, and right away the plague came from God and struck the people. And the only way to stop the plague was when David offered repentance, and the angel of death stopped at Arona field. And this point, David decided that this should be the place when he should build the temple. Of course, he didn't have a chance to do it, but his son, King Solomon, built the temple in Arona field. This is the field where the curse or the plague stopped. Exodus chapter 31 talked to us about two important items. One is God carefully chose his servant. Two skilled artisan God picked to design and make the tabernacle. And the second part of it talk about how to honor the Sabbath day among the Jewish people. So God told Moses, "See, I have called someone named Bezalel, the son of Uri, the son of Hur, from the tribe of Judah. And I have filled him with the Spirit of God in wisdom and understanding, in knowledge, and in the manner of workmanship. And he also gave him an assistant. I also have appointed with him Aholiab, the son of Ashimach, from the tribe of Dan. And I put wisdom in the heart of the gifted artisan." So that tells us God takes very good care of his work. God wants us to be very careful about the type of service and ministry we offer. He picked people and filled them with wisdom, with knowledge, with understanding. God doesn't like a sloppy job in his work. God wants to take care of the details and fine details of his work. The same way we have seen with his creature as maintenance of this world. Then the second half of this chapter talk about the Sabbath day and how we should honor the Sabbath day. And God gave very strict rule to Moses. And he told him, "Speak also to the children of Israel, saying, surely my Sabbath you shall keep, for it is a sign between me and you throughout generation, that you may know that I am the Lord who sanctify you. You shall keep the Sabbath, therefore, for it is holy to you. Everyone who profane it shall surely be put to death. For whoever does any work on it, that person shall be cut off from among his people. Work shall be done for 6 days, but the seventh day is the Sabbath of rest, holy to the Lord. Whoever does any work on the Sabbath day, he surely be put to death." So God was very clear about his command of keeping the Sabbath. And now let's see what's happened later on. We read in the book of Numbers, chapter 16, that about man, that he completely violated the Sabbath, disrespecting God and his command, and he went around and started to cut trees, gathering woods, to start make a fire and start making a celebration at home. The people found him, arrested him, and brought him to Moses and Aaron. And Moses and Aaron prayed to God, and God told Moses, "The man who must surely be put to this, all the congregation shall stone him with the stone outside the camp." So it's clear to us that whenever God gives a command, he's very serious about it. The same way he gave Father Adam a command not to eat from a tree, or he surely will go unto this punishment, and he did it the same way he did throughout the whole entire Bible. That tells us how important it is to know God's command and to keep him. In the New Testament, we add the Sunday or the Resurrection Day as a day of the Lord. So although we still celebrate Sunday, but we still honor Saturday. So we have those 2 days as honor days in the church. And when God finished all his talk with Moses, he gave him the Ten Commandments on a tablet of stone written with the finger of God. Chapter 32 is actually a big downfall for the Jewish people when they make their greatest sin by ignoring God's command, worshiping golden calf, Aaron tried to make a defense of himself, was not acceptable, and got punishment. Moses' intercession on behalf of his people and God's fair rule for punishment. When Moses went up to talk to God and receive the instruction how to build the tabernacle and the Ten Commandments, he spent 40 days and 40 nights. The people down in the mountain got frustrated that Moses didn't come back, and they went to Aaron and said, "Come, make us gods that shall go before us. For as for this man Moses, who brought us out of the land of Egypt, we don't know what has become of him." So they went to Aaron, asked him to make gods, because the leader who got them out of Egypt disappeared. So they need their own God to lead them through the way. That's very superficial thinking. How, if they make their own God, this God will have intelligence or knowledge to lead them through the way if he was just born or created by them? And Aaron said to them, "Okay, I'm willing to do it. Break off the golden earrings which are in the ears of your wife, your son, your daughter, and bring them to me." Here come a question. They were basically poor slaves in Egypt. They barely have food. So how did they get this golden earring? And abundantly, they were there among all the level and the people, among women, among daughter, and even the sons. He received the gold from them, melted, fashioned it with engraved tool, and made a molded calf. So it was not a simple procedure. It took him a lot of effort to do it. Then they said, "This is your God, O Israel, that brought you out of the land of Egypt." That's very phony. If they just made this calf now, how can this be the God who led them out of Egypt? How come they forgot about God who makes the 10 plagues and crossed the Red Sea and killed Pharaoh and his army in the Red Sea? But tell us how bad humans are. They very easily forget God's favor with them and start making their own sins. So when Aaron saw it, he built an altar before it. So not only he made the golden calf, but he also built an altar for it. And Aaron made a proclamation and said, "Tomorrow is a feast to the Lord." So now Aaron actually made triple mistake, maybe four mistake. He listened to the people. He got a plan, get the gold, melt it, fashion it, make a golden calf, built an altar to it, and finally declared this is a feast. So everybody will follow Aaron. That tells us how important and how grave the mistake of the leaders. Aaron was the leader of the people. Now his sin gonna mislead thousands and thousands of people. Then at the day of the feast, the people sat down to eat, drink, and rose up to play. And when the Bible used the language "rose up to play," this is a very delicate language of the word sexual immorality. And this is always a common habit. When there is drinking, when there is alcohol, people usually lose their common sense. And the first thing they do is sexual immorality. That was fornication and adultery. So the people went from ignoring God and his leader, Moses, from worshiping God to building a golden calf, worship him, and fall into sin and adultery. Then God told Moses, "Go get down, for your people whom you brought out of the land of Egypt have corrupted themselves." Because any time you do sexual immorality, you actually corrupt your body. You don't own your body. This is the temple of the Lord. As St. Paul once said, "Honor God and your soul and your body, which are his possession, which are God's possession." Now they defiled themselves, and God asked Moses to come down and look at the people. They have made themselves a molded calf and worship. So Moses came down very angry, carrying the Ten Commandments, and he saw the people, and Joshua was following him. And God said, "I have seen these people, and indeed it's a stiff-necked people. Now, therefore, let me alone that my wrath may burn hot against them, and I may consume them, and I will make you a great nation." So obviously, God found nobody good among the Jewish people except Moses and maybe his servant Joshua. So he made a vow to Moses, or an offering to Moses. "If you let me, I can destroy this whole entire nation, around 2 million people, and I grow you and multiply it to make you another nation. The same way he did with Abraham, he can do with Moses. But Moses, out of his good love and fear and intercession on behalf of his people, he pleaded with God. And he said, Lord, why does your wrath burn not against your people, whom you have brought out of the land of Egypt with a great power and with a mighty hand? Why should the Egyptians speak and say, he brought them out to harm them, to kill them in the mountain, and to consume them from the face of the earth? Turn from your fierce wrath and relent from this harm to your people. And start to remind God with his old promises to the great father. Remember Abraham, Isaac, and Israel, your servant, to whom you swore by your own self, and said to them, I will multiply your descendant as the star of heaven and as this land that I have spoken of. I give it to your descendant, and they shall inherit it forever. So now Moses actually is a very religious, holy man. He's not only plead with God and make a case before him, but he also using the people who are very close to his heart, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And how you promise them that you're gonna multiply their descendant like the stars, and how you're gonna give them this holy land. And for everyone who deny intercession, now we tell him, just read Exodus chapter 32. You will see a great story of intercession of Moses on behalf of his people. Then he took calf which they had made, burned it with fire. That's what Moses did when he came down. He took the calf, burned it with fire, and ground it to powder, and he scattered it on water and made the children of Israel drink it. Of course, gold might look very nice when you wear it, but it's really a bitter taste when you drink it. So Moses meant that they should taste their own punishment. And when he confronted Aaron, Aaron tried to make a very funny excuse. See, the people are evil, and they brought me this golden earrings, and I put it in the fire, and that's how it came out. Of course, Aaron wasn't very honest here. He actually had a great part of deal here. He's the one asked him for the golden earring. He's the one melted, shaved it, and make it as a golden calf, and built an altar and call it a day to the Lord. So actually, Aaron is the main one who is in charge of this mistake about worshiping the golden calf. And thus says the Lord, the God of Israel, let every man put his sword in his side and go in and out from entrance to entrance throughout the camp, and let every man kill his brother, every man his companion, and every man his neighbor. So the son of Levi did according to the word of Moses, and about 3,000 men died. So now this came the God punishment. Whoever committed himself to worshiping the idol and do sexual immorality deserve to die and should not be allowed to live among the holy people of Israel. Otherwise, they defile the entire congregation. And when God asked Moses to make a call and a shout to make a punishment, a harsh punishment to the people, only the son of Levi or the son of Levi stood up next to Moses and killed 3,000 infidel men. Moses went up back to God and start to intercede one more time and said, oh, these people have committed a great sin before you and have made for themselves a gold or a god of gold. Yet now, if you will forgive their sin, but if not, I pray, blot me out from your book which you have written. Now, this is really a great intercession on Moses' side. He prayed to God as if you give God a choice. You either forgive their sin or blot me out from your book, which means I am on one side and the sin of this whole people on one side. If you don't forgive him, then blot me out. Erase me from your book. So Moses here showed a great love for these people, although they are not really worth it. They are a group of infidel. They are a group of people who never keep the honor and the great word that God made to them. They don't deserve to live. But still Moses, as a good shepherd, he took care of them and intercede on their behalf against God. Now the Lord said to Moses, whoever has sinned against me, I will blot him out from my book. So this is a fair rule of justice of God. I'm not going to punish anyone for someone else's mistake. Whoever sinned deserves to be punished. You don't made a sin, then you don't deserve to be punished. Now, therefore, go, lead the people of to the place of which I have spoken to you. Behold, my angel shall go before you. And that will conclude chapter 32. I have here a few spiritual meditation that I want to talk about. First of all, how did the poor slave, the Jewish people who lived in Egypt, got these golden earrings? The answer, we have read it in the Exodus. They got them from the Egyptian as a payback for their servitude. God asked him to go and ask their neighbor, the Egyptian neighbor, ask him for golden article. And the Egyptian people, out of fear from the Jewish, they gave him all the gold that they have. And that was considered as a fair payback to all the years of servitude that the Jewish people working for free. So that how they got the gold. Second question, why did God tell them to ask for gold article from the Egyptian, although he knew they would use it to make golden calf? So God, with his utmost knowledge, he knew that later on they would use this gold to make a golden calf and worship the idol. Then why God asked him to do it in the first place? Okay, here is the answer. God wanted to destroy all the memories from slavery in Egypt and rely him only and not the gold. They came out with the gold, thinking they're gonna make a new life very similar to what they used to live in Egypt. They make a god very similar to the gods of Egypt, and they have the gold to make it. So now when Moses melted down this gold, it tell him exactly, you have no one else to depend on except me. I am the true leader, I am the true foundation, I am a true pillar for you. Count on nobody but me. This is the golden calf that they worship in the desert. Another question, why did the Jewish people choose a calf to worship as a god? Why didn't choose any other idol like a star or a bird in the heaven? Because the calf actually was a holy or sacred animal to the Egyptian, they worship it. And they tried to recapitulate what they used to do in Egypt. They saw the Egyptian worshiping calf. They also want to be like them, completely ignoring what God had did to them and the 10 plagues and crossing the Red Sea, as if they never happened before. And that gave us a hint. Anytime you have a bad experience with sin, or you mingle with sinner, or you assist with sinner, even after you leave and repent, you're still gonna carry a tray of evil memory with you. If these Jewish people lived in an isolated area, never seen the Egyptian worshiping calf, when they go outside, they'll never ask for a golden calf to worship. But because they lived among the idols in Egypt, they carry this trail of thought of sin. They should made a golden calf himself, the same way the Egyptian worship golden calf, they also want to worship golden calf. And that gonna reflect on the first commandment that God gonna give to Moses, that should worship him only and not to make an image of any other creature, nothing that fly in earth, nothing that walk on the earth. Everything should be only God and God only. Next question, why did God choose the Levite to be priest? Because obviously here, when Moses heard God's command to kill the infidel, only the son of Levite stood next to him, and they carried their own sword and went ahead and killed the infidels. That tell us those are really the one who has zeal for the word of God, those who has passion for the word of God. And that takes us to a very important spiritual rule, which is God chose those who choose him. God chose those who stood next to him, who choose those who stand up to God and God rule and God command. Those the one that God really chose and honor and respect and excel in his kingdom. And the last question, why did God choose the bull to be the sin sacrifice of the priest? Later on, when we move to the book of Leviticus, we'll hear about the sin sacrifice and did count, it depend on the level or the rank of the sinner. And for the priest and the high priest, it has always to be a bull. While for a simple person can be something like a ram or a goat or even a pair of doves. So just tell us how important and what the grave impact of the sin of the leader. As Aaron was the leader of his people, his sin was so great. So every time he's gonna offer a sacrifice, he's gonna remember his sin that he made all the Jewish people fall through by his wrong advice. So his sin actually reflected as a sacrifice that he has always to offer to remind him of his own sin. This tells us the mistake of someone simple can be easy forgotten, but the mistake of the leader of the congregation, of the church, has a grave and dire impact. That conclude chapter 32. So we cover chapter 30 till chapter 32 in the book of Exodus. We talked about the altar of burnt incense, the incense, the holy oil, and the census. We talked about honoring the Sabbath, and we talked about the great fall of the Jewish people and God's punishment for them. Thank you very much for your attendance, and I'll see you next week. And glory be to God forever and ever. Amen.